Okay, welcome back. Let us look at the function of the Electoral Commission of India. What are their duties? What are their obligations? Once they are given that mandate to carry out their duties, what are they supposed to do? One, they are the one who prepare the register of voters. And here, you find we say that the voters are supposed to register prior to voting. So that register, the work of that register is to make sure that whoever is voting is the one who is qualified to do what? To vote. So it's the work of the Electoral Commission to come up with the guideline who is qualified to vote, who can be registered and who cannot be registered. Number two, they also have the power or the function to draw the boundaries of the constitutions, constituencies, whereby each constituency, they normally use the number of people in that constituency to determine the geographical area and the other historical background. They also compile a list of parties to participate in the elections. So when you want to register your party, you normally go to the Electoral Commission to be able to be registered as a political party. They also establish polling dates. They are the one who give the dates when the elections can be conducted. They also give the allocation of symbols of party. You know, if all the parties they use the same symbol, you might end up being confused. And therefore, they allocate them symbols. If this one is using lamp, maybe the other one is using axe, the other one is using different symbols. So that even the poor does not know how to read, they can be able to identify their people using those symbols. They also receive nomination paper from prospective candidates, and we say once you want to file, you have to prepare your papers and submit them to the Electoral Commission of India. It's also their duty of counting the votes after the elections, and you find that this counting of votes, it's normally transparent because they count it in front of the party agencies, and finally they announce the results. Now, what are the conditions necessary for voters? Because we have said the Electoral Commission, they tell who is qualified and who is not qualified. So for you to qualify to become a voter, you must be a citizen of India. That means either by born or by registration. And then you must be age of 18 years and above. That way you become a voter. And remember we say they use what we call universal suffrage, whereby once you're 18 years, despite of your status, you are capable of voting. Then another condition is that you must be of sound mind. You are not insane, you are not mad. You are somebody who can be able to make independent decisions. Then one has not been convicted of serious criminal offense. You are convicted of murder, robbery with violence, and the like, and you have been jailed for some time. Then you must be not corrupt, does not engage in any illegal practice, and therefore, if you meet those qualifications, you are free to vote or to become a voter in India. So what are the conditions necessary for a parliamentary candidate? If you want to become a member of parliament, what are the conditions? One, again, you must be Indian citizen. Then you must be 25 years and above for the House of the People, and not less than that years for the Council of State. So if you want to be either of the two, you must be either 25 to become a member of parliament, or that years and above to become a council of the state. Number three, the third condition is that you must provide personal details in one's nomination papers, that you don't have any criminal record, and in any case pending in court, assets, liabilities, government dues, and one's educational qualifications. All this you must submit them when you're giving your nomination paper. So if you meet all the qualifications, you now qualify to be elected as a member of parliament or a member of the council of the state. Now, what are the conditions necessary for the presidential candidate? One, you must be an Indian citizen, and also you must be 35 years and above, and you must also meet all the conditions that a member of parliament meets. So, in case in an exam, your hands, the condition, the first two major one is that you must be a citizen of India and that 5 years and above, while others just fall like those of the member of parliament. So what are some of the campaign methods that people in India use? They use print media, they use electronic media, whereby they use maybe internet, Facebook and others to advocate for their party, and they also use public speech where they conduct rallies and canvassing in order to gain people to elect them. Now, we have so many political parties in India, and we have the main ones, which are four of them. One is the Congress Party, or the Indian National Congress. That is the party that Mahatma Gandhi used to become the first Prime Minister of India. Then they have another one known as Bharatiya Janata Party. It's also a party, it's one of the major parties. Then the Communist Party of India. And we have other small parties, we call them the regional parties, like Indiana, DMK, and then the National Conference, and the Telangana, the Sun. So those are some of the political parties that are found in India. Like here in Kenya, if I understand this thing, the political party, there are so many, but we have the major one. Like in the last election, we had Jubilee and we had the ODM, just the same. India, they have so many political parties, but the major one are this one. Let us see how does their parliament look like. So that is their parliament. The parliament of India is very beautiful. It's loud in nature. I don't know why they build it like that, but that is the parliament. It has two houses, and the two houses are here. We have Rajyasabha, we call it the Council of the State, and we have the Lok Sabha, the House of the People, or the National Assembly in our case here in Kenya. So those are the two houses. If you look at these two houses, you find Rajyasabha is somehow not so much congested like Lok Sabha, because Lok Sabha has so many people. You see, they have almost 545 members. Now, what are the functions of the Indian government? We have said it's a federal government, and being a federal government, they have to come up with some units, some way of governing. So I'm going to start with the registration, whereby the registration is a bicameral parliament, where we say bicameral means it's made up of two houses, that is the upper house. Another one, we call it the Council of State, and we refer to it in Indian language, Rajya Sabha. Then the lower house, or the lower chamber, we also call it the House of the People, we call it the Lok Sabha. And then Lok Sabha is the one with the many people, because it has 545 members. So the language that are accepted in those two houses, you can either use English and Hindi. You ask me why English? They were colonized by the European, by the British, and remember, even us in Kenya. That's why you can use Kiswahili, and also you can use English. So, the function of the House of the Registration, we find that they initiate amendment to the Constitution, so they can bring amendment in the Parliament, and then they can change some areas or some section of the constitution. They also scrutinize bills before they become law. So any bill must be passed. Remember we said they are the one who make and amend laws. So it's their responsibility to scrutinize these bills before they are made laws. They also approve the budget, and there's no money that can be spent in India without the approval of parliament. They also debate on national and international matters that are affecting India or their direct concern of India, and they can also impeach the president. Remember we say there is no other organ of the government that has the power to impeach the president apart from the parliament. So if they find he's not acting according to the constitution or he has gone contrary to the will of the people, they can impeach him. They also oversee the administration of the country while the government are conducting their issues, and they have the power to call any member to come and present their way of administration. They can even call the ministers to come and discuss the issues that are affecting different ministries. That is the legislature. Let us look at the executive. So the executive is made up of the president as the head of the executive, and the president has the foreign powers. He has the veto power. That means he can accept or veto a bill. So he has the power to accept or to reject a bill. That's what it means by having veto power. He is also the commander-in-chief of the armed forces, and he appoints state governors and Supreme Court judges with the approval of the parliament, and also he appoints the prime minister with advice of the parliament. And we say the prime minister normally comes from the party with the majority seats. Then he is also a symbol of national unity, and he has the power to declare an emergency and rule by decree during times of problems. So in our next lesson, we are going to continue from there. We'll know what are some of the functions of the executive and also the other members of the executive. Have a good day. Stay tuned.